Gonna go any second. Live from downtown Houston, Texas, that is Learn to Paint with Ginger Cook Tuesday night. Ginger, the fans are looking for you.
Hey, John. Welcome, everybody, to our live show. This is anything can happen when you do live. We don't have an editor push button. It's just whatever happens, whatever I say, I said, right? I guess the most I can do is we don't even bleep it. So here we go. But what we're going to be painting tonight, Learn to Paint with Ginger Cook is a little bit longer lesson than we do normally. We're going to try to keep it to an hour, but if it runs over, it just does. And what I want to share with you tonight is that we're going to be painting one of the old masters, a man by the name of Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec. I used to think his first name was Toulouse, but apparently not. Toulouse-Lautrec. And he was a very, very famous French artist. He was known for his cabaret scenes, dancing women, portraits. And I went through a lot of his pictures, and some of them were, quite frankly, you know, too nude or too inappropriate. They were interesting, but, you know, probably not something I'd want to share with you guys. But on the other hand, he had this one dog that just reached out to John and I, this little picture of a dog. I'm not sure whose dog it was. But I thought, you know, we could do this dog on the show. He's adorable. And we can show a little bit about fur, something like that. So that's what we're going to be painting tonight. And I'm going to stop you all right here. If you are new to my channel, if you haven't known much about Ginger Cook Live, I'm an acrylic artist. I'm a master of acrylic painting. I've been doing this for over 50 years. Really, no kidding. And when acrylics first came out, nobody knew a thing about them. A lot of the techniques that I share with you on this channel and on our academy site, our academy school online, are techniques that you won't learn anywhere else. I promise you, this is some interesting stuff in the way I go about and see the world. And then ideas for me to teach you to paint like you, which, like you, or to, but let me say that again. The idea isn't for me to teach you to paint like me. It's for me to teach you to paint like you. And how you're going to learn to paint like you is by finding out how other artists did it, okay? And try different styles. And eventually, like handwriting, you have something that's uniquely yours. So we're going to be exploring this this dog tonight. And if you haven't had a chance, if you're new, please subscribe to our channel. We appreciate that right now. Just take a moment, hit that subscribe button. Then there's a little bell underneath it. Then if you hit that bell, you'll be alerted when we do a live class. Sometimes we've been doing some impromptu things, really kind of fun. So this might be something interesting to do. Now, in the past, I know I've encouraged people to paint along. This is probably not one you might want to paint along with. It stays up on YouTube. I suggest, really, that you kind of absorb what I'm showing you, because I'm going to go pretty fast and I'm going to go over some techniques, but we're going to start from beginning to end on this dog. We're going to finish it tonight. I think he's going to be really cute. John, have you focused shown us the dog yet? Have you shown people?
Yeah, let me pop
that
up.
Let's just show you guys. This is what we're going to be painting. Come on, is that not adorable or what?
Is that a good looking? I think he's a Muttley.
Kind of a mutt, you know, he's the kind of dog that if he wandered in my yard, I might be tempted to adopt, a little red bandana on, something like that. Isn't that funny that everything stays the same? Whatever's different, but it still stays the same. So that's what we're going to be painting. And you'll notice in the picture, if John has it up again real quick for us,
okay,
or you can focus down on my table if you want.
Oh,
I'm going to show you something. Just focus down on my table. I've got a photograph of him, all right? And
there you go.
You'll see his background is very dark. It's almost a dark purple. It's got some blue in it, and he's sitting on some sort of old shag rug. Boy, I remember the shag rugs from the 60s. I guess they weren't the first shag rugs, okay? Everybody thinks their generation has all the new stuff, but apparently not. So what I've done is I've created a background using these colors, and I'm going to do that real quick for you, show you how I got this background. This one's dry, because that's what I'm going to need, is a dry background to put the dog on. But real quick, I'm going to just, do you love that real quick stuff? I'm going to...
Oh, there's a hidden brush.
There's a hidden brush. Well, things roll. You know, it's not really hidden, they roll. All right, so let's put... I've got a canvas. These are 9x12 canvases that have already have a color on them, like an underpainting color. I'm going to do a second coat. And incidentally, I don't know if you can see it or not. Can you see this little dimple in the canvas?
Yes.
It was leaning up against something and bumped. Do you guys know what you do with that?
I don't.
This is really important, because sometimes really good-natured people in your life can say to you, that's a big canvas. Can I carry that in for you? And then they put their knuckles kind of through it and, you know, kind of in it, and they punch it. And then you're thinking, oh, you made a bump in my canvas. So see the bump? What you do is you just turn it over and spray water on the back of the canvas. Now, your canvas happens to be cotton duck. And if your laundry skills are as sad as mine, you probably shrunk a few things in your life. And if the cold water doesn't work, too hot. But basically, this will tighten that canvas right back up. Anytime your canvas feels a little loose, it should be tight as a drum when you're painting. So if your canvas is loose, why don't you just give it a quick turnover and miss the whole thing? Tighten that up. It should sound like a drum. Okay, so probably that's a good tip. Wasn't that just cool?
I think it's enough for the night.
Okay, so John thinks enough for the night. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to wet this. I've got this brush. This is a Filbert number 12, Ruby Satin Silver Filbert. And I told you I had the colors of purple, phthalo blue, and ultramarine blue, and a little red. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to come over this whole canvas again. I'm going to wet it real quick. I want to show you. First you do an underpainting and let it dry, and then you do a second coat, because you want some color on here. You want some paint on this canvas, and a lot of you might be tempted to start at the first coat, and I don't recommend it. I did for my lesson. I've already chipped it, and if I had done it this way, it wouldn't have chipped. And just a little piece of trivia here. So you see how we're just kind of, you know, putting this on here, a little bit more of the purple. Now, as I get down toward the bottom, okay, I'm going to take a little mixing white and a little phthalo blue, and I'm going to come up here like this and make these little X's, like that little mixing white, phthalo blue, and just make some little X's using the side of my brush, like that, a little more mixing white, like that. Mixing white is not as bright as titanium, and this will give you a good basis for that. And then I'm going to come up here using that same mixing white. I'm kind of out. Let me put a little more out there on that palette here. All right, here's a little bit more on my here. So now, because this is still wet, I can just come up here like this very quickly and indicate some lighter, you know, highlights, something like this. Just like this, just around here, and I'm going to come back down here like this, a little bit more mixing white in the front, and create that sort of shag rug effect. Just almost like little X's, like that. And then in a few places, I want it lighter, so I'm just going to come down here and just kind of scrape it on. All right, like that. So you basically, that's sort of your background. Now, if that gets a little too purple for you, what you can do, you can take a little bit of burnt umber and just a tiny bit of that and just add that to your background too if it feels a little purple. I'm pretty sure he used black. I'm not. I guess you could. You could use black and some of these colors too, darken it. Certainly could. All right. So there you go. So that would be, then you let all this dry, and that's your background. Now you can add more to that later. For instance, phthalo blue is pretty nice with, I took some burnt sienna and phthalo blue and a little bit of white, a little tiny bit of burnt sienna. I don't want to take much because I need that for the other picture. You can add some more. So you see how that makes it a little bit greener? You can come in here and add a second color on top of this. So you can kind of play with that. But that's basically the gist of how you do this background. Okay? So I'm going to put that down and bring this back up. And you see what I mean here? I was just brushing something off of it, and I've already gone down to the bare canvas. That's because I didn't do two coats. Now, a dog like this, and we're still on the, I take it we're still on the, you're still showing me on the table, right, John?
Yes, we are.
Okay, so a dog like this, I think some people might balk at, you know, drawing a dog like that on. We're tonight, we just did a blow up of the dog, and we're going to go ahead and chalk it on, but I want to show you how to draw it anyway, okay? Because I think once you'd see that, if you break down a shape, okay, and this is my chalkboard here, and I want you to see the basic shape of this dog, it's almost like a one big rectangle here. Do you see that? One big rectangle and a small one coming out here. So if you understand that, and then you got to think there's an angle here, and the paws, it comes down and they come out this way. And then this paw in front is because it's looking at you. It's just a half circle, all right? And you've got his chest, and then if you look at his little face, I mean, if you could almost do the measurements, here's three fingers from his chest to his face, and three fingers again, three, that kind of thing. So when you're doing something, figure, look at the proportions. What is the proportion between here and here? How wide is it? And you can kind of see, if I drew a straight line, where would it fall in there? So when you're drawing something like on, this is actually a fairly simple shape to draw on, but just to keep, but we will have on our website available for you guys a traceable, and which will be just this reverse image like this. And what you do with this is you just take some chalk and color the back of this really well like that. Just color the whole back of that a couple of times. All right, make sure that you've got it high enough. Let's see, how high up do I have to go? About this high. All right, so I'm pretty good there. All right, and I've shown this before, but I think this is a good, this is fast. I mean, you can spend some time drawing it on. I totally believe you can draw it on, okay? I believe you can, and I think you could. This is a really pretty simple shape, but on the other hand, maybe you don't feel like it. So now I'm going to position my dog about where I want him. And there's a couple secrets to doing this. Oh boy, she's telling secrets again. Assuming I can find all my stuff. I love stuff. Finding stuff. Don't you, John?
I do.
I think finding stuff is so entertaining.
Can I ask a question while you're doing that?
Sure, because I'm going to need a pen here.
How do I keep from getting paint ridges in my paintings?
Somebody says, how do you get paint ridges? You know, you are painting. You're supposed to have ridges in your paintings. It's paint. It's supposed to be thick and textured. That's the idea. We're not, if you want really flat paint, use flow or use a, it's not like watercolor. You're supposed to have texture and ridges. This thing's going to have texture all over it. But you could, for instance, buy golden opens, which dry really flat, and they're much smoother, okay?
More like a watercolor.
More like, well, they're not really like watercolor in that sense, John, but they're, but they really go flat on you, and if you have to buy the texture for them. And acrylics, if you put them on real thick, they'll have a tendency to when the water evaporates, you're going to get whatever's left of the plastic. So I'm going to move this on here like this. I'm going to tape this up. I'm going to need a pen.
Do you happen to
have one, John?
Let me take a look.
Do you happen to have a little pen here? You want to use a pen and not a pencil. All right, that's really important. And I think if I have, do I have a pen in here? You're going, I don't know, Ginger, it's your box. Okay. Oh, I have a pen. Never mind, I lied. I've got one. Okay. All right, so I'm looking at him going, this is kind of where he is. He's down toward the bottom, see? So I think that that's fairly reasonable. All right, so we're going to, let's just see if this works now. Make sure if I don't have to, yeah, it's working. So basically, I'm going to just outline him. Kind of scribble him on here. Little footies. Little more footies. Little more footies. Oh, I love this dog. Isn't he cute? Kind of. All right, you're just trying to figure out where he goes. Is this just... Oh, we didn't get enough chalk down here, so we sort of lost the chalk at the bottom. So let's do this. It's easy enough to do. If it's not chalking, it's chalking everywhere except right there. See, that's why you do that. Would that work? Oh, yeah, that worked. Here's this foot like that. Okay. And this is kind of coming. Here's a little dark patch right in here. Here's a little dark patch right in here like that. Now, I'm not going to try and do his eyes. I just might come up here just where his eyes are. Put the eyes in the nose, just so I kind of know right here where the little eyes and nose go. His mouth was interesting. It was all off-center and kind of crooked, and John says that's how those dogs are. All right, so this is basically what I've got. Let me just see if I've got this enough here. I have enough information. I just think I didn't get enough chalk right in here.
All you're doing is putting chalk on the back, right?
Just chalk. All I'm doing is just putting chalk. There's paper you can buy. It's called transfer paper. Okay? The problem with that is that you don't always have it. And then you don't have the right color. But if you use a new pastel chalk, at least you've got the color, right? Got it. Okay, so here we go. I'd say that's pretty good. Let's see. Let's come under here like this. Put this line. I'm just trying to think what information I absolutely have to have. All right, that's good enough. This will get me a start, right?
That's good.
There's my dog. And you see, I've got enough of an outline here. You might have wanted more detail. If you did, then you could do more. And then I've still got my reference photo, which is cool, which I'm going to use. I'm going to put right here to the right, move all these little brushes away, put these where I can get them. There's my reference photo. And when you're doing something like this, here's the colors. We've got burnt umber, cad yellow medium, yellow oxide, which I apparently never got out on the plate, cad red medium. This is titanium white in a log, phthalo blue, dazzling purple, burnt sienna, and ultramarine blue. Those are our colors. Pretty much the colors we use all the time. Nothing's changed.
No fancy colors today.
Pretty much anything. And now we're going to be using a 1/4-inch ruby satin silver angle brush. And we're going to start with our darkest color first, which is going to be dark brown, a little ultramarine blue. Put those together. And that's going to be up here in this ear area. I've got some of that, some dark brown. And I know I've got some under here. Ultramarine blue and burnt umber, which is why I didn't put it in the background. Okay. And I already have some dark on the dog, so I just want to make sure I have it where I want it. And I think that's we've got some dark right here next to where his back leg is, and it's a little bit dark. And then we've got this light area, so we'll just put that there for now. Now, let's take a little bit of yellow oxide and burnt sienna, make a little color here like that. I'm just going to come on up here. And using the angle brush, just like this, I'm going to just put in this little ear here, kind of like that. And I'm going to come over here and just indicate a little ear here at this point, some little ear. That's cute, and I like this color underneath his face. So we're going to come under his eyes, under here like this. There's some of this color on each side of his eyes. Okay, this is something that gets built up in layers, you guys. You don't do this in 10 minutes. You just don't. It looks very simple, but you're really not doing this in 10 minutes. Let's take a little bit more of the burnt sienna, darken that up a little bit. Same thing up here. Let's just put a little bit more paint up here. Got something under the eyes here. Down here on the leg. It's like doing a puzzle. Where else do you got that? Where else do you have this color? And I think as long as I'm doing that, I'm taking a little cad red medium and yellow, making a little bright orange color, and putting a little color down here on his feet as long as I can. Let's see, here's this other little foot right here. I'll put that in. Now I pinch the brush, and I'm going to come up here on top of these colors with a little bit of that color up above his eyes up here like this. Okay, because these, we're going to build up layers using these. Okay, so I've got to figure out where I want the red, and then these other colors will come in, all right? I'm going to put this kind of red color. It's going to come up here like this. And we got something in his chest up here like that. There's something going on up here. And I'm going to bring this up closer to me. I guess I could put my glasses on. I almost have to bring this up closer to me so I can see it. That's being able to see it, blow stuff up. One of the reasons I suggest to my students to own an iPad is because you can blow up the pictures that you're doing. You can make them larger. And as one gets older, one hates to, admit it, but there is a certain amount of stuff that makes it a little harder to see. And trust me, if you can't see it, you really can't paint it. Okay? So we're going to come under here like this. Start bringing our fur out like this on his face. Both sides, widen his face. It's going to come under here where his nose is. A little bit of red above his nose, a little bit of red up here. Okay, so can you guys kind of see what I'm doing?
Now,
I'm not
scary.
Going in for details on the face yet. Can you see that, John? Is that working?
Yeah.
Sure, I can answer questions while I'm painting this in. Okay, I'm happy to. Now we're getting into some lighter colors. Same brush. Okay, question?
I am looking. I think I've answered everything that's going on right now.
Okay.
And the admins have been helping with the light source, daylight. And, we're right on top of it.
We're on top of it. Okay, so here we go into some, all right, here's some color. Now, purple, grays, yellow. So if you have yellow and you have a little purple out, which we have here, purple, grays, yellow, because it's opposite itself on the color wheel. So if you need a little darker yellow, add a tiny bit of purple to it, like that. Now we're going to come up here like this. I'm going to start bringing in some of his fur, like this. Just as a fun little dog, and I love his little hippie dog here like this. He's got this little hip coming down here. Here's this little back foot here, back this way. See? I mean, it's very cute, and how this works is you absolutely have to start layering the colors. Now, this was probably a trick when you were doing oil painting because nothing was drying at all, okay? Can you imagine? Nothing was drying, so... Wow, this is a challenge, this little painting here. So we're going to get back under here like this, with it under this eye, and around on this cheek. It's a little bit brighter under these eyes.
Do you know when we're releasing Wildfire?
Wildfire gets released in January.
It is January.
Yeah.
Okay, let me grab my calendar.
Okay, yeah, no, Wildfire gets released in January. We've got so many beautiful, on gingercooklive.gallery on our website for our online academy school, we've got so many beautiful animal paintings. John will show you some of these later today, just to inspire you. When you have over 250 lessons, it's hard, no one's going to paint all of them, I don't think. You're going to paint the ones that are interesting to you, but if you're an animal lover, you might be more interested in one of those, say, than something else, okay? So, again, we've got horses and animals and cats and stuff, and it's fun to paint different things. I really like, sometimes I'm in the mood to paint a dog or a cat, and, you know, that's nice to do it. Gosh, when you look at this really close, he even has a little collar, he has a collar, John, and he has some, a little tag, a doggy tag. How adorable. They had doggy tags back then. Come on, that's cute. I mean, you guys, that's really cute. Now you can see how he's starting to take shape, even though we've done very little, right? And it's all about color, little dabs of color here and there. It's almost an abstract in the way that the colors are put on. This is impressionistic painting at its best. I love it very much. You can go, Cinnamon and I were lucky enough to be in France and go to his museum in the town of Toulouse, and they've got the whole city kind of wired off here. Now we're going into a little purple to show the different furs are going back and forth like this. That, you know, it's like a walking city. You know, it's all the traffic, and you go park your car, and then you can walk. And the buildings are still the same, probably as their big cathedral there, really big, pretty cathedral, and all the little tourist shops have stuff. I should have worn my Toulouse-Lautrec scarf tonight. I forgot. We're gonna do a master's on him, and we definitely will do a master one on him. Although it was a little bit of a challenge, we were looking for paintings we could do,
and it took us a little bit of time, didn't it?
Well, I mean, it was a little bit shocking, and then because he was a little bit similar to, that's that little dog collar here. He was similar to Degas in that he recorded the life and times in France. And so, probably the girls of the night, you know, were his, a lot of his subjects, and the way they were, I mean, pretty realistically sad. Now we're going into a little purple here, like that. See, a little bit of purple.
It looks like Wildfire is going to be released on either the 19th or the 26th. It's still in my hands being processed. It's not going to be on YouTube. It will be in the members area, and we are debating if we're going to put it up for sale or not. I don't know if we've determined that yet, have we?
Well, yeah, and usually we don't put it up for sale right away. If we were to put it up for sale, it'd be several weeks after. The members always have first shot at this stuff.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, sometimes you want to own something for your own personal library, and our members are subscribing members, and even the weekly ones, they can get a discount on our
downloadables. Yeah.
You know, see, it's coming along, isn't it? I mean, he's not there yet, but look how fast he came in. I'm going to come up here with a little purple.
Here's a question on the Master Series. Can Ginger talk about Renoir and the luminosity he achieved on the skin?
Well, I'll tell you what. One of the ones we would be doing, Renoir.
So we'll take a peek.
So we would take a peek at that and talk about how that might be happening. You know, there's so many. You know who was the really amazing artist was Lord Leighton. He was an American artist. Everybody talks about Renoir, but I'm telling you, we Americans were no duds. You know, they don't like to talk. You know, we've had some pretty awesome artists. Mary Cassatt, by the way, was an American, but I'm just saying, right? And Lord Leighton did oil paintings, but he did them very backwards to what most, what you consider most oil painting artists. And that he's, you know how we always start from dark and go light. He started from light and went dark. And he has his pictures glow, I promise you. It's glow. All right, see how we're just starting to build up a little bit on the fur, on the ears. Mm-hmm. Kind of shape an ear like that just by adding a little bit of color. Here's our little, still using this angle brush. Angle brush is absolutely perfect for this.
Here's another question for you. What are some good exercises to train your eye to see different tones in a picture?
That's a good question. What would you do to train your eye? Because it really is an eye training thing. One thing you could do is that turn the picture into black and white and look at it from a black and white standpoint, all right? And then see what you've got, okay? So we're going to come back here with a little blue here and fix this ear. Okay.
Whoops. Lord who again?
Lord Leighton.
Leighton.
And I'm telling you what, he did one of Cinnamon's favorite paintings is Flaming June. And he was, again, he was really popular in the 20s. And then one day he went out of popularity and he just didn't do well as far as you know, toward the end of his life, because that's what he did. He painted these sort of scenes from ancient Rome, and when people didn't want that anymore, that was just the end of it. You know what I mean? And it was really kind of sad. He didn't have another genre. This is what he painted. You know, the more you learn to paint, you know, as an artist, things do go out of style. And if you think I'm kidding, back when I was in my 20s, what was really in was daisies and old pickup trucks. Okay? Couldn't give that stuff away now. Now it's starting to come back, but a little different. There are paintings, certain paintings are never dated, but there are certain subjects that are definitely dated, and here we're going into some lighter colors now. See on top of his head.
Hey, what about training your eye to see the actual colors more clearly?
Well, again, we have something on that. We have a whole thing we did live on YouTube. Remember on the greens? We've got that. I got a video on how to do that, you know.
Wendy, go find that.
Yeah, we have that video. We just did it just a couple weeks ago on how to do that. Okay? And I'm not going to put anything over his eyes yet but I am going to start putting some of this lighter yellow here. Do you see what we're doing here? A little bit lighter yellow here and then on his chest. We're starting to lighten it up a little bit. And start putting some light fur here. Now, I haven't done his mouth or anything. I've just kind of avoided that. I'm going to do that last in his eyes and his mouth. But I'm just trying to get this stuff here. Now we're going into the lighter colors. See, this is cut. You know, this is a yellow oxide and a little bit of white. Okay, and we're starting to put the lighter fur coming down this way on his leg.
Here's a good comment for you with a question.
Yeah.
I have noticed that you do not use water when you paint, but others do. Should you or should you not?
Well, I don't. And, you know, you got to understand, I have been doing acrylics since, you know, I was 17. When they came out, nobody knew anything about them. And I had to figure it out. And what I have figured out for myself, and this is just my own thing, is that I use water to occasionally change the brush, clean the brushes. And for the most part, I don't use water. And sometimes if I need it for a little detail. But, I mean, that doesn't mean that other people are wrong. It's just how I do it. Okay, there's a lot of different ways to paint something. You know, that's what I would tell you. A lot of different ways to paint something. You want to make sure you're leaving the light clear on top of his head here. Let's come up here with his eye now. like that there. Okay, so I don't quite have his eyes in right, but I wanted to get that. And then I'm going to come back into some Cad Red Medium and yellow, make a bright orange color, because he's got some serious orange under the eyes here now, and I'm using a small brush. And so, you know, when you're using water, water thins acrylics, and it depends on the acrylics and the paint. You know, if you got student grade paint, you may be doing something one way, and if you don't, you have another. And, you know, a lot of it depends on the paint you're using. He's got a collar. I got to get this up where I can see it. Good grief, he's got this little collar right here. Let's take a little red and put that collar in before we bury it. Here's his mouth. So he's got this collar. Come on, you guys. This is cute, isn't it?
It's a red collar.
It's a red collar. Can you see it in the picture, John?
Can I can see a little bit.
Can you barely see it? You see this little red collar sticking up under here? Come on. And you know, you think a collar, and then it's up, it adds a little blue to it. It's a little burgundy off to the right, not quite so bright red. See, off to the right, it gets darker. But here's his red collar coming this way, under his shirt, or his fur.
That's his shirt.
My shirt. Here, fur. It's a little bit darker here, and it's brighter red over here. Okay? And then down from that collar, you see, don't be rinsing. I'm just wiping my brush off on a rag. Down from that is a little bit of a, there's a little dog tag right here. Huh? How cute is that? Okay.
The only thing that's scary on that dog right now is his mouth.
I know. We haven't even worked on that, see?
I know. It just looks scary.
It does look scary, like a Cujo, right?
Yeah.
So you want to come back, and if you have to, come back with this. This way you know what the background is, so you can come back. Here's his little dog tag, something dark under here. It's coming up dark here. Let's take a little bit of Cad Red Medium and a tiny bit of Dazzling Purple, make a darker red. That's another way you can make a dark brown, kind of a reddish brown.
You want to know what kind of dog it is? I say one with four legs.
He's a Sooner dog, John.
A what dog?
A Sooner dog.
A Sooner dog.
Yeah, Sooner one kind of dog than another.
Ah, Sooner a Muttley, dog. As it were.
You never heard of a Sooner dog?
No, little Muttley.
That's Cinnamon's dad's favorite thing. He used to call them Sooner dogs. One Sooner one kind of dog than another, and he got that from his dad. You know, we're all just subject to the, you know, funny stuff, right? It is kind of funny, though, you got to admit.
It is.
Now, acrylics dry darker, so you may have thought you got those ears in. And guess what? You didn't.
You get to do them again.
Because they just sort of disappeared on you when you weren't looking. So here's a little ear coming out like that, and I'll probably cut some of it off. Oh, how perfect, right? Here's a little bit of red here by his cheek and his mouth. And he's got some darker red coming under here by his nose, like that. Darker under the eye. Let's make this a little bit darker under the eye here, too. This is all darker under here. Like that. I don't know. Do you see how we're doing the fur? Everything is going which way? You know, this is going, the fur here is going down like this, and this fur is going out this way, almost in a herringbone pattern. I thought one of the reasons this was a good example of how to paint something was because there's a tendency to want to draw something in. And in painting, you know, a lot of times it isn't drawn in. It's little tiny brush strokes that when you're done, it makes the image. All right? So that's what you're going for, little tiny brush strokes that turn around and make the image when you're all finished. All right? So so when you think about it from that standpoint, like, for instance, obviously there's a little bit of his back right here. And then under here, it's very dark under his chest right in here, but you see a little bit of the fur going up this way, so you'd have to pull some of the dark going up like that. And let's see, I see a little tiny bit of the tone. He doesn't really show the feet or the paws. He just shows a little bit of dark down there. Might be toenails. Who knows what it is? Again, this is what we call impressionistic painting. I mean, it's very cute. Let's see, let's just pull off this ear a little bit here. Let's just chop that one off like that. Haha. Good.
Ouch.
Let's see, what else can I do here before? I'm going to have to get our little eyes going here. All right, so I wanted you to see this. Do you see this? This is a magnifying glass. You guys see that? And if you're having trouble seeing, what you can do, You put a magnifying glass over what you're painting. I found this on Amazon. We'll have a link for it, right? And now when you paint underneath it,
now we can't see where you're going to be painting because we're on a different angle.
But I want you to see that when you paint underneath it, do you see when you paint underneath it? So what I would do then to put those eyes in, or you can do that, or you can use it to figure out what it is you're supposed to be painting like this. You can magnify your picture. Now, my suggestion would have been, and I wish I'd thought of it, I should have taken this dog's face and blown it up huge so then I could see exactly what I was painting. That would be a tip I would certainly recommend doing. We're going to switch brushes here. I'm going to go into a little dodging purple, a little pointy brush. And I did put water on the brush and then rolled it out because I want a little bit of liquid. And I've got at some point put these eyes in. All right, so I'm going to come up here. But I wanted you to see that that's what you had an option for. Put the eyes and the nose in. And it's very dark in here where this little eye is. And over here, it's dark. And then I'm coming down here. Actually, this is the nose right down here, a little further. And he has a little purple and white. The only thing you see on the nose to indicate a nose, and I can just go into the white because the purple's wet. The only thing you can see on the nose is a couple little dots across the nose to indicate there's a nose. There's a little light in the eye right there. You don't see anything else in the eye. And then he's got this little cute pink tongue. You really don't see the mouth either. If there's something dark, and then there's this little pink tongue sort of sticking out here on the side, like that comes out of his mouth like that, okay? And then underneath all this, this is why you need a little brush, underneath all this, around his mouth, like for instance, there's his tongue, so this is gonna be more chin here like that. There's not a lot of, so we're gonna start creeping up on his mouth a little bit like that. Okay, it's kind of cute, right?
It is cute.
And I mean, if you think about it, all we did was we left a space for his eyes and they kind of came down, that dot's too big, so I'm gonna make it smaller. And they came down a little bit. They were round shaped, kind of almond shaped like this, there we go, like that. And here's this one. And then the fur came down over the eyes, in front of the eyes like this. Like that, there's some fur that came down. And the same thing here, you didn't really see the eye, you just saw some little tiny, light colored paint. And it came across his nose like this, on the top of his nose, it came over and kind of around like that. Let me just rinse the brush now to get the different colors. It's almost an orange now. And it's dark red, except for the top of the nose. It's kind of red underneath, okay, where his nose is. All right. And then it's kind of red right here, red over here. And let's get some burnt sienna and purple makes a nice deep dark brown. So we'll put some dark stuff here on both sides. Okay, like that. A few little longer fur away from kind of underneath his chin. Okay, and it's all kind of dark over here. I think it's interesting that how you would create a picture like this. When you duplicate or try to emulate what someone like this painted, you have to start examining how they did it. What did they do? Did they have this? Where's the light things? What went first? Is there some fur that came out this way here on the ear? The lightest stuff is on top, and some real almost white here, really white back up here, not quite white. He probably used like an antique white. It's up here on his head. There's a little tiny bit of white right here by his mouth. Okay, and mostly it's a very very almost an antique white. So let's see, and then he's got some. A little bit of light fur coming over the collar like this. It's got some light fur coming this way and out to the side. And then I love it. He's got this couple of purses of fur over his eye. Now here's where the water comes in. See my little water? I want water just on the tip. Can you see my water, John? Can I move it? I'll move it over here, right here. All right, do you see the water just on the tip of the, just on the tip of this? Now, I want a couple of very deliberate strokes of something over his eye here. Be able to see that, right? Okay, so there's his, you know, his nose, okay? And the same thing here. I want some little tiny lines of there, over his eye. See what I just did? And that's where the water on the tip of the brush happens, right? Just on the tip, not the whole brush. Roll it. Come up here. I want this deliberate brush strokes here, and maybe this one, okay? And some here like this. And this is going this way and out here. All right. And let's just make sure I have this one. It was very light right here, right? Like that, okay? Okay, over his eye. And then right over the top of his nose, just here, he had a little bit of light right here. You want to roll your brush. You want to paint just on the tip. And here on the top of his nose, and it was a little oranger than that, was it? Not quite that bright. Okay. And then right here on the side of his cheeks, he's got some long fur. And again, water just on the tip. This is interesting. When you use water just on the tip for this flowing stuff, maybe this is coming up here like this. A few little deliberate brush strokes. Something here. So a little bit something under here. Some more orange. Now, if I'm using the brush to mix with, then I am going to put water on it. Okay. Now, I've got some more bright red coming under here. Got a little bit of red here. Let's just take some Cad Red Medium and exaggerate this. There was some red right here. A little bit of red up here. Here, and then on the top of his ear right here, we're going to suggest an ear. Same here. Just a couple little brush strokes. A little bit of brighter color right there on his cheek, like this. And it, you know, you could try this with a different dog. It wouldn't have to be this dog. Once you sort of figure out that what he did, here's some little brush strokes coming down this way on his chin. Now, kind of almost in a, like a little arrow area, like that on his chin, underneath his head. Okay. And then here's some of this way coming out like this. Now we're getting sort of crazy with the little brush. And then how about up here like this? Kind of following all with me here?
So far, so good.
Okay, and now, see, we're all layering, right? See, we're all layering.
What size brush is that you're using?
This is just a little tiny 000 one I got at Jerry's, a little pointy, you know, ink brush. And, you know, I go through these because they don't, nothing seems to last very long, but it's not even a ruby satin. It's just a, you know, a little brush. Usually I like do the ruby satins. I only own one ruby satin, and I did it in. Wasn't their fault. I left it in water. I mean, you can't blame companies for your stupidity, you know?
Well, you can, but it won't go far.
Well, it won't go far. Here's a little bit more red in his mouth, like that. There's the red on his collar. I'm going to take a little bit of brown now and thin that collar up right here. I had it too, a little purple. Thin that collar up right here, like this. See, I had it a little bit wide. And there was a little bit of blue. Where'd this blue come from? He's got a little blue in him, ultramarine blue and white. Some sort of gray color. Well, that's interesting. Here's a little gray here. Oh, he's got some gray in his fur. A little ultramarine blue and white and brown. Look at that. I missed that, but there it is. See, it's amazing what you don't see. What you don't see that's layered. There's even a little bit up here in his head. Like that. Cute. A little bit of fur here. How about some here on the inside of his fur? So you can see how he's coming together. Don't you think he's coming together? Does it look like, I mean, it does to me, but let's just make this a little smaller now. Let's take the some fur and put it around his little piece, this little necklace. Everybody knows who belongs to this dog. I think it's just so interesting that they had that stuff too. I don't know why, that I wouldn't think they did, but I think it's interesting. All right, so I'm coming along here like this with a little more of the light fur out to the side.
What's the longest you've ever kept a brush? How old was it?
I'll tell you, I don't try to, it sounds like I'm a hoarder. I try not to throw them away. The pointy ones I throw away because I can't think what else to do with them. But I keep them because I can do something else with them. But I've had one really in good shape. Those Galleria number 40s for the big, when I show you how to do the big pictures, those are excellent brushes, those Galleria number 40s. Now, you know, they really are. They're absolutely excellent brushes. Let me see if I can, now here's what I would tell you to do. When you get about this far, what I would tell you to do is to put this in, hold it up to a mirror. Here, make that a little smaller here. Hold it up to a mirror so that you can see what you've got. Now I'm kind of redefining the eye here, like this on both sides, making those lines a little smaller, on eyes on both sides, and then make sure I've got something really dark under his mouth. And it's very dark off of this way, here, like this. Okay, like this, kind of on this side, it got real dark. Got a little dark here, got a little bit of dark right there. But I mean, we're getting pretty close to being done with him. And I know that sounds funny, but we can still layer some more light on him, right? We still need to have some more light coming up here. That ruby sand, I've had some of those for years. The trick is, if you want brushes to last, try to be a little nicer to them than I am sometimes. You know, wash them, light, dry them flat, never put a wet brush up. You're standing up like this. See how we're doing? See, we're adding a little bit more fur to him. Then the lights, get a little light off of this way. Little tiny bit of water, roll the brush. There we go. There's something on his foot here. Okay, you're going to get that out of the way now. All right. There's a little tiny bit of light right under his chin right here. I'm going to put that like this.
Ginger, who are some of the American painters you admire?
You know, I love Kent Wallace and Howard Behrens. Those are two American painters I absolutely adore. Howard has since passed away, but I knew him. I own one of his originals. And Kent Wallace is an artist from Salt Lake City. Really wonderful artist. Back about 20 years ago, you saw a lot of his work in IHOPs, in prints. And he does lots of color. These two artists are really big on color. You know what I mean? You see the color. They were just, you see the color. They were just about color. And of course, I'm about color. So, I mean, they're a great influence for me. Okay, so just bring some of this red around his face, a little bit in his chin down here like this as I'm talking to you. Okay. And let's see, what else can I do? I think what's appealing to this dog is the fact that he is so shaggy. And coming back here on top with a few little darks now. Normally we go from light to dark, but sometimes you have to come back. And there was a little dark here by his foot. And then this kind of came over it like that, like on the top of his foot right here.
What's the scroll with it. What's the most difficult painting that Ginger has done?
Well, years ago, Cinnamon was in college, and my gallery had got a request from a man who was president of a large commercial air conditioning company in Houston and in Dallas, okay? And he came in and he said, do you know any artists that would come and paint our stuff, you know, what we do? We install air conditioners, so we want someone to paint, backhoes and the whole process of how these guys put in air conditioners. And we want 12 48 by 60 paintings. And we think that would just be great. And, you know, Gene approached me and I said, you know, I think I have a friend that's an artist and I think he would be perfect for that. This sounds like such a guy thing to me. No offense, but did, right? I said, I think he would be just the best, okay? And that you see, I'm doing a little orange here now. It's going to brighten this up here on the feet because acrylics dry darker. You think you've got it, and then you don't, right? A little bit more orange here on the side. A little bit orange here on the bottom of this foot. And so anyway, he had seen my work in the gallery. He says, what about this artist? And I said, well, she's a landscape artist. You know, Jean said, but I'll ask her if she wants to do it. And I said, I think you should get, you know, I named two other artists I thought would have been better, right? Because you want people happy, okay? He says, oh, no. So I approached Cinnamon at the time. I know she knew it's in college, and she needed money. And she was doing more of that. When Cinnamon went and took art in college, she was they were teaching her, you know, some of her drawing exercises were painting hair dryers and a lot of, you know, kind of weird things and a lot of commercial things. And also, she was a very good photographer, and we were going to have to go out and get photographs of all this stuff, okay? No question, for sure, right? And so I said, Cinnamon, I said, I'll tell you what, do you want to do this? And I'll just sort of, we'll just do it together, and you can do it, and we'll do it together. What do you think? Because I really don't want to do this. I mean, this is not my bailiwick. I don't want to do it. So she said, yeah. So we had meetings, and she went out, and she got some really good photographs, because Cinnamon, you may not know that about her, but, you know, she's a really, really wonderful photographer. And then she said she'd tackle a couple of them, and I would, because she had college and didn't have a lot of time to do stuff. And I would do, for the most part, I would do them, okay? Well, what I discovered was there was no joy in me in painting a drinking fountain. You know, the kind, the metal kind where you put your foot on the pedal. I mean, that was just, this was stuff was hard. Not because it was hard to paint it, but you have to kind of like what you're painting. And I got to thinking, you know, there really wasn't enough money to compensate for how unfun it was to paint any of this stuff. And, for instance, I painted a backhoe. I don't have any pictures of these. I wish I did. Something happened to our album on that stuff. But you know, we're lightening up the head up here. See, again, one more shot on lightening up the head and the nose here like that. And then we need some little fur coming down this way. Rinse the brush, pull it to a point. Very light. Now we're going to do this. So anyway, I did a backhoe, you know, where they were digging, because they wanted where they were digging the ground and everything they did. And so then I had the reflections of that big furrow, and there was water, and I reflected the backhoe in the water so that there was all these reflections. They were actually very pretty paintings, but they were a real struggle for me because I would ask my husband at the time, what is this? And he'd go, that's that. And I thought, okay. And unlike a tree, where if you think a branch would look nice here, or one of these little, like right here, what we're doing tonight, right? One of these little whips of fur would look good here, and maybe we got something coming down over the nose like this, right? One of this kind of deal, right? Like that. Something coming down over the nose like this, see? One of those. Those wires have to be in just the right place, and we heard about it. They had meetings, and we had to have the right clothes. They wanted some of the pictures of some of the employees in this stuff. And then they, you know, it took a long time. And it was a very frustrating experience, and they were happy with it. But I understood then, and Cinnamon and I both got a really valuable, I would say very valuable lesson out of this. And the lesson being is that don't take commissions. I don't care how much money they're offering, if you don't have an affinity for what you're being asked to paint, because it just isn't worth it. Really not. And that was probably that, you know, everybody should have one of those kind of life lessons there, you know, about that stuff. I think I'm getting pretty close to done here. What do you think, John?
I think it's looking pretty good.
Is he looking kind of cute? I mean, let's
Here's an unusual question for you. I just opened my last canvas board out of a pack. This panel has 8 to 10 bubbles under the canvas throughout. So it sounds like the canvas wasn't adhered to the board.
Yeah, it sounds like it wasn't.
So it doesn't. You can't really do anything with that other than take it back.
Take
right?
it back. Yeah. And get your receipt. And just think of it. You know.
Or use it for a practice board and.
Well, I mean, why should you have to pay for defective stuff?
Well, it's true. I guess it just depends on where you got it and what the hassle is.
Well, there's always the hassle factor, right?
You got to consider the hassle factor.
Okay, I'm going to just do a little bit of this blue-gray color, which I had somewhere here.
If you do a commission, should you take half down?
If you do a commission, you should take half down, you bet.
Absolutely.
You bet. And I tell you what, I'm not, and I don't like, I learned a long time ago that I want commissions out of somebody's dreams. I dreamed this. I need you to paint it. It's like trying to go to the hairdresser and describe how you want your hair. Have you ever done that? And then they have, you get something else, and you're like, what? This isn't what I was thinking.
Was it in my head? I didn't. That's not what I saw.
Yeah, they don't know what you saw. And guess what? You know, they don't know. Okay, I promise you, they don't know. And, you know, it's the same thing if somebody's, you know, I had this dream, I think you should paint it. No, I didn't have the dream, so I'm sorry. And that's really, it sounds like you're being mean. You're not being mean, you, because they're going to just complain.
I'm going to pop up the original for a second. Can you pause for a moment?
They want sure, to see the let's original. Just pop up the original, let you guys see what I'm doing here.
Let me, I think this is him.
How are we
okay.
doing?
That is the original. How long have you been? You're at 55 minutes.
55 minutes?
Yeah, you're doing good.
Not shabby,
that's
right?
That's the original, guys.
That's the original? And here's and this. Here's our little guy here, right there.
And that's what Ginger created.
I think, you know, I didn't put it out, but I'm thinking I want red. Apple crimson. I'm just going to put out a tiny bit of red here. Just a little bit of red. I think I want some real red here, just back up here in the ear. Maybe here on the collar. There we go.
Oh, that's a good question. Does the acrylic paint flow easier if gesso is applied first?
To what? Gesso is applied first to what?
I guess your canvas.
Well, listen, you can't paint on canvas that doesn't have gesso on it. That's what the white stuff is. It's gesso. The white stuff is gesso. Acrylic paint's better if you have acrylic paint as a ground, as if you have an underpainting. Okay? That's
basically, the more paint you have on it. Right?
That's why it's so much easier to paint over an old canvas than it is a new one. Because acrylic paint paints better. I'm going to just try a little bit more, a little bit brighter reds here on some of this. Pop this up a bit. Just in a couple places here. I'm just going to pop up the puppy here. Oh, he's cute, isn't he?
Canvases are half price at Hobby Lobby for those that aren't reading the comments.
Some people are not. I've heard some comments about that from others. And check with your friends. Do a poll. How many people like those canvases? And anybody had any problem with them?
Ah, there you go. Well, we had comments about the Michaels one. Isn't the one we got?
Well, yeah. And the thing of it is that, you know, if you put enough stuff on it, you can make it work.
Yeah, well, yeah.
You know, Frederick's, you know, a good brand of canvas is Frederick's. I've never had any problem with Frederick's. You know, Texas Art Supply used to sell it. I really like Frederick's. Paramount is sold by Jerry's. I like their canvas, Paramount. You know, you get what you pay for. Not just in the stretcher boards and stuff, but also in the finish of what they put on the canvas. All right? So you definitely do that. Definitely get what you pay for. Actually, I think I like him kind of, John. I think he's kind of cute.
I think he is too.
And he had a little ball. Can you see in the picture there's a little ball?
Is it really?
Yeah, like right here. There was this little ball here out of white or something. There's this little tiny indicator, kind of a white-gray ball. Let's see, let's make a white-gray ball here. Take a little brown and some white and a little bit of blue. Little tiny bit of blue. There we go. Let's make this ball. He had a little ball here, right here. That was kind of buried in the carpet like that. And there was a gray side to it. I think he just sort of indicated that when he was playing, you know, painting around. Here's a little bit of white part. There's a little ball here like that, which is cute. Come on. And then he had... I mean, you could spend more time. If you understand the principles of how you'd paint this, could you spend a little more time with the little furry things? Sure. You know what I mean? Doing stuff like this, making a few more little furry stuff. Yeah, and, you know, making sure that you've got these colors right. There was a little bit more red right there under his face. And a little bit of dark under here, like some of that color was under here. On his nose, that kind of thing. I think you could, you know, his little ears are flopping over like that. But you kind of get the idea of how you might paint something like that, I hope. And let's see, we had a little bit of just something here like this, and this indicated the bottom part of him, something like this. Oh, yeah, and he has some bright yellow fur coming down here on this back leg. I mean, as I go, you know, and I see where the acrylics are drying darker, I keep wanting to lighten up the fur in front, because, again, this is all about layers. And, again, the little shorter furs up here on his head, little shorter ones, like a little bit lighter over his eye here. Okay, I'm just going to... I love this little... He has this one funny little, tiny little white line over this eye, kind of a little bit of fur over these eyes like that, over his nose, top of his nose, like that, and then something light here on the side, okay, like that, and something here. I just love how he painted this dog. It's just happy to me. All right, and something in here like this. This side. I don't know. I think if I keep going too much, I might just... I think I've done him pretty well. You know, it's an example of how you might paint the dog. Let me just see if I... Wait, I'm looking at him. You guys know me. As I look at him, I'll see if there's anything else I need to do. He had a little bit of this fur coming around his little tag. So anyway, Cinema and I, the guy was happy with the pictures, but it was a pain doing 12 of those. And we both decided then if we didn't like the idea of the painting, that there wasn't enough, you know, I mean, and I'm not saying that the money wasn't appreciated. I'm just saying that sometimes you can't let that be your only influence. You better like what you're painting and have confidence in it. Let's see, there was some light on this collar right here, like a gold where it fastened. Oh, look at that. See where the collar fastened to
the little buckle
where it fastened to the chain. And then there was a chain. I can't believe it, there's highlight on this little thing right here. And I don't know why this is gray here, but there was some gray-green stuff in here. Kind of a gray color. You know how to make gray, you know. And there you go. A little bit more gray in this side of him. All right. So then probably what I would do is take my other brush, which we were using. That one goes in water. And let's just work on the front here a little bit now while we're talking. This has been about an hour in this picture?
Yes. Yep, just about an hour.
All right, so I'm taking a little ultramarine blue now, and I'm going to come in here like this with a little ultramarine blue and white. And let's see, let's put a little bit of red with it. There we go. People sometimes have different blues that they use. He might have used a cobalt. I'm just sort of not sure. All right, here's some thalo with that. There. I'm just going to start... making the fur. Now, maybe this is snow. Do you think this is snow and not a shag carpet?
I'm thinking shag carpet. They had shag back then in the 1800s, don't you think?
It could be snow. I don't know. But it was lighter under here like this. There were some light bits here. And it was very dark purple right next to him like this, right in here like this. It was very dark. Like next to him, this was very dark. And like a little shadow next to him, this is dark up in the front. This was dark here, right up into here, it was very dark. We don't see any of the blue here, see? This is why we're going back, okay? And then we came down in here, we didn't see a lot of this light blue up in here, more into the purple, kind of around where our ball is. Take a little bit of red here. See what I got. A little bit of blue here. So that's why you need to remember how you did your background colors. Okay. And then we had some, maybe just some blue and white up in here. Like in the front. Okay. And his ball was sort of, I know that the ball is, I think, feel this was a ball, right? But I'm just going to sort of... his ball was a little washed out here like that there. I feel that's a ball. Might be a snowball. I feel that's a ball. He's ready to play.
Well, you're the artist.
Oh, no, I'm just going to lighten up some of this in here like this. Bring it down. Do-do-do. All right, we're going to call that done. I think that's sort of a fun thing. And again, you've got the picture here. And if you want to spend time, put a little more detail on him than I did. I think we did pretty good in an hour. And Toulouse-Lautrec, what a nice artist. And I think we'll probably feature him in one of our Learning from the Master shows. And if you haven't seen the one we have done on Degas, we did Sunday, check that out. I think that's really fun. I encourage you guys to subscribe if you haven't. Likes and comments are appreciated. And the more you share our videos, the more other people see us and they share and so forth. And that really helps us get the word out on what we're painting and what we're doing, which is, I think, we've got something kind of unique here on our channel. It's a little bit different than all the other wonderful artists that are out on YouTube showing people stuff and taking their time to do it. So, and we appreciate your time watching. And I'll answer a couple more questions, and then I think we'll call it an evening. What do you think?
Well, we don't have any questions going on right now. Why don't we show them a couple of our other... I got Brandy's dog up now.
Oh, yeah. Now, that's a lesson on our web. Brandy, that's one of our clients, one of our members, who sent us a picture of her dog and said, would you paint this for me? Brandy's puppy. Now, that's an original Ginger Cook. And I'm not that dissimilar. Come on, you guys. There's Brandy's puppy. I mean, you know, this is probably why I was attracted to this dog.
And then here's the black and white cat.
Yeah, we have a black and white cat. Did you? Let me show you this. Let me just show you this.
Oh, let me bring it back to you now.
Yeah, bring it back to me. I want you to see. I'm going to move this for a second. And these are some downloadable videos. This is a downloadable video that you can, step by step.
You're going to the close-up camera? Gotcha.
Yeah, close-up camera. Can you do that?
Yeah, you betcha.
Give me the close-up camera. This is the chimpanzee. And I show you how to grid this in. This is a downloadable. You can own this video. Really good video for downloadable. It's just on our website for sale, but it's really an inexpensive lesson. And I think he's cool. And you learn so much about doing eyes and all this stuff on his nose. There's that one. And then check out, this is in our members' library. This is
a Rottweiler.
Yeah. And this was Sandy Bell's, I think it was at Sandy Bell. Anyway, one of the Paint My Photos, I got that from Paint My Photo, the actual photograph of somebody's dog. It's either Warren or Sandy's, I'm one of them's dog. And I love the fact that there's no black in this dog. This is all done with the same colors we did tonight with this little scruffy dog that we just painted tonight by Toulouse. It's all done by the same thing. And yet, this is a step-by-step creation, 8x10. And really, if you can master painting dogs, and one way you can kind of support your painting hobby, you know, it's a good way to support it, is to consider, doing dog portraits. You know, take a few classes from me, figure out how, get the skinny down on how to do animals, and you've got, animal people are very fond of their animals. Sometimes they like them better than their kids, really. And my brother, he had a pot-bellied pig after his kids had all grown up, and he said he'd wish he'd got that one first. He would have rethought the others, right? But, what can I say? And I'm telling you what, this pot-bellied pig, it started out little, right? With a miniature pig, started out about the size of two Coke cans, and the thing got to be as big as this table. And he let it live in the house. And when you'd eat dinner, go over to his house, and it would, you're eating dinner, would sit there and bite you on the leg. And he kept saying, it doesn't do that. I was like, my leg is the one that's getting bitten. Why are we eating dinner with this stupid pig, right?
And she should be on the plate.
I'm telling you. And the pig would sleep in the house, and then the cat would sleep on top of the pig, and he had a chicken that slept on top of the cat. I mean, I wish I had a photograph. Wow, they just, I'm saying some people are a little crazy about it, but I'm sure if somebody offered to paint a portrait of his pig, he would have bought it. I'm just saying that's how crazy he was.
And well, he loved his pig.
He just didn't want to hear a negative word about it. And the idea that it bit the guest was just, he just couldn't believe it because his pig wouldn't do that. Well, I'm glad it didn't bite him. And anyway, here's our dog. I'll put our dog back. I think that's funny. Go to our website, gingercooklive.gallery. Remember, if you want our little traceable for this, we'll have that available for you. And we talked the other night about, you know, how to do printouts like this. I mean, look at this color printout. And somebody asked me about that. I mean, here's the printout for this painting, all right? And somebody asked me about that. And I've got a printer that I got for Christmas. And then since then, I've discovered there's like five on these printers that HP offers. And they've got a deal. I was subscribing for $3 a month, up to 50 pages of full color, like this, of ink. That was just gratis. And when you start to run low, I got another package of ink in the mail today. And if I went over by 50, it was a dollar for every
15 more.
So John decided we might up the game, and I'd spend $5 a month so I can have 100 pages, which is what we're going to be doing. But there's not a better deal out there as far as I'm concerned. And when HB thought of this, I'm sure they didn't think of us artists. They weren't considering us guys going, like, it's like going to a buffet, you know, when you could really pack away the food, let me put it that way. They look at you and go, oh, Lord, you just came to our buffet. We were really hoping for more thin people, right? And, you know, because they kind of lose money on the others. But anyway, this is a great deal for us, and we have a link on our website to it if you want to find out about that. And I think somebody said they found one printer in that group that was like $80.
Yeah, they got some very cheap. There's like 10 or 15 printers to choose from.
That 10 or 15 printers that choose them, so you don't have to get anything too fancy. But I think, the ink deal is the deal. I mean, they're onto something. And what John just has ran out of ink for his printer is going to be $100 to replace all the ink. You know, it's almost cheaper to just buy this another printer from HP and get on the ink program.
Yeah, that's what I'll do for this one. And we'll re-ink that when we can afford to do so and have it for our fine art.
Yeah.
But for these quickie things we're doing for reference, that's all you need.
Yeah, because I did a lot of these, and I don't even think about it, you know? I don't
worry. You just press the button.
And then the other thing is, when I start to run low on ink, I don't have to sit there saying, I got to go to the ink store. What kind of ink was it? Do you remember what kind of ink we bought the last time? Remember that junk? They just say, by the way, we're sending you some ink. We see you're low. They know. It's like Santa Claus. They know all. Really,
it's handy.
It's handy. I've got to say, I forgot to mention that before you. I've been doing this for about a year. I think it's just super. So anyway, you hope you guys like this. What's up? This was fun. This will stay up. Hope you try it.
Yeah, this is Ace Up on YouTube.
And, you know, if we have a Ginger Cook a 92 on Facebook. That's my Facebook.
Ginger.cook.92. Oh, I think it's GingerCook.92.
Is it? Whatever it is. GingerCook.92. Okay, GingerCook.92 on Facebook. And I'm, you know, happy to friend you. I love to have friends. And let's
be friends.
Let's be friends. Let's see what you're painting. Love to see it. I put the stuff up that either comes from our website or from one of our lessons. And that's what I generally leave up on my... and then on Pinterest, I started the 2017 gallery, too.
Yeah.
On our Pinterest board, too. So that stuff's going up, too, from YouTube paintings and also from our academy. So hi, everybody, and just a shout-out to everybody. And
then one last comment. The printer, the printout tonight was printed on that particular printer, her HP printer with the cheap ink.
Yeah.
And the paper, we got glossy print paper from Costco.
Yeah.
It was just the cheap stuff.
Yep, cheap stuff.
Because, again, these are just references, and that's what we're using them for. Hey, we'd like to thank everybody for joining us this evening.
We'll be back tomorrow.
Are we going to be back tomorrow?
We're going to be back tomorrow, John.
Excellent. Do we know what we're going to be doing tomorrow?
No.
Excellent.
Do we have to know?
I mean, it's not tomorrow yet. No, we don't have to know yet.
It's not tomorrow yet. I don't know what we're going to be doing. Everybody says, look, put out the colors. Look, these are the colors I use all the time. Just have those colors. You're pretty much safe. Yeah, my colors just, you know.
Yeah, the colors are always the same.
Colors are always the same, you know.
Very seldom do we throw in a weird one.
You know, just, you know, very rarely, because.
There's a period between, it's Ginger period, Cook period 92.
Yeah, there it is.
Thank you, Wendy.
Thanks, Wendy.
So we're both right on that one.
Well, I don't know. By the time I got around to Facebook, Ginger Cook was gone. You know, the word, you know, this is gone.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I was late coming to Facebook. Cinnamon and Kessler sister, you got to do Facebook. Oh my gosh, just one more thing. I so resisted. You know, when email first came out back in 1992 or 3, and someone was talking about it, I said, why would you want that? Just another thing to do. And now we practically are wet-wired to the phones, aren't we? I mean, every day, did you check your email? Did you check your messages? They've got us all trained, you know.
Yeah, we're like monkeys.
We're trained.
Yeah.
We're trained.
All right, everybody, thanks very much, and we will see you tomorrow. Nice. Live and in person.
Likes and comments are really appreciated. And remember, any comments you make now sometimes don't show up, but if you come back and make comments, we see them better, because yours all disappear.
Right.
And then YouTube, you know, YouTube does some weird thing with this video. With, I don't know, they call it processing, and then when it's up officially, when we'll see the thumbnail and everything of the dog, you'll know it's up officially, and then if you comment, then we really see it.
Now, they're asking about the picture behind you. Yes, I did get a picture of it done. I didn't get it loaded. We'll show that tomorrow. Hopefully, I'll get it loaded. So you'll see the picture tomorrow. Do you know, did the game ever get produced that picture went for, and do you know the name of it?
It was based on a series of famous books called Riffs or something.
Riffs?
Riffs. And John was doing the video game of it, and it never got made. They came so close that there was the stock market or something crashed again about the time they were ready to launch, and some of their investors backed out. They were very close to it. But it was,
That happens.
It didn't get made.
Alrighty. That's it for this evening, guys. See you tomorrow. Thanks so much. Subscribe, thumbs up, and share.
Bye.